Hey, how's it going everyone? I'm Mike Pointer, and since my previous couple of videos on the various graphical capabilities of the Super Nintendo have been pretty popular, and I love diving into this kind of thing, I thought it would be a good idea to do a video on some more unique tricks the SNES could pull off that are strangely not discussed very often. So, let's get straight into it. I'll start with one of the major differences between the Super Nintendo and its competition at the time, and that's its ability to create transparency. Now, it should be noted before I go any further that this isn't actually real transparency, technically, it's just simulated, but it's still a very convincing effect that couldn't be done on other hardware like the Mega Drive or the TurboGrafx-16. So, how exactly did it work? Well, in order to explain this, we first need to understand a certain aspect of how the Super Nintendo drew the images to the screen. Because technically, it's not screen, as in singular, but screens, as in plural. What you see displayed by the SNES's output is actually two screens combined together, known as the main screen and the subscreen. Yes, it actually has two screens in its VRAM. When writing a game, programmers could basically choose what they wanted to put on each of these screens. More specifically, they could choose which of the background layers they wanted on each screen, and whether they wanted sprites on each screen. Keep this in mind because I'll come back to it in a moment. If you watched my video on the Wolfenstein 3D port, I mentioned how the SNES has 8 background modes, labelled 0 to 7, with mode 7 obviously being the most famous. But all of the other modes provided various levels of background layers, colours, and special functionality. Mode 0 gave you the most number of layers, which was 4, but had a limited colour palette. Mode 1 was probably the most common mode, as it gave you 3 layers and a nice amount of colours to work with. Mode 2 was like Mode 1, except it sacrificed a layer in order to provide offset per tile, which is something that I covered in the Not Mode 7 video. Mode 3 gave you 2 layers, but one of them had the most amount of colours available, so it was often used to display high quality images and cutscenes. Mode 4 was like Mode 3, except the amount of colours on the second layer was reduced in order to provide offset per tile. Mode 5 had 2 layers that were very limited in colours, but was one of the SNES's high resolution modes. Mode 6 was like Mode 5, except it only had 1 layer in exchange for offset per tile. Mode 7 provided only 1 background layer, but allowed affine transformations like scaling and rotation. That's just a higher level overview of each of the background modes, but if you want to know more, I'll leave some links in the description to check out. When talking about transparency effects, only modes 0 to 4 were capable of doing them. This is because the transparency effects were created with color mats, and these were the only modes that supported that. So for now, we'll only concern ourselves with the first 5 modes, but don't forget about those high resolution modes, modes 5 and 6, because I'll be circling around to cover them a little later in the video. So, back to the main screen and subscreen thing. Depending on what mode the game was using, the programmers could allocate the available background layers, and also the sprite layer if they wanted to, across the two screens. It was also possible to just not have anything on the subscreen at all, which resulted in it being just a single fixed colour. After doing this, they could apply colour maths between the two screens to simulate transparency, either colour addition, colour subtraction, or colour averaging, depending on what kind of effect they wanted to create. This could be done even if there was nothing on the subscreen, as the colour maths would apply to the single fixed colour. Colour averaging was the most popular method, and resulted in what most of us would recognise as transparency, being able to see through something to see what's behind it. Whenever you see transparent water, or weather effects like fog for example, that's being done with colour averaging. Here's a few examples of colour averaging in action. Color addition or subtraction was usually used to simulate various lighting effects, like spotlights or shadows, by making things look brighter or darker respectively. This may not be immediately obvious as a form of transparency, but that's exactly what's going on, a transparent color is being put on top of the screen, often with part of it hidden or clipped to display the final image. Here's some examples of color addition or subtraction being used. At this moment, you might be asking, wait, how does part of the background get clipped? Well, in addition to the main screen and the subscreen, there's also a third factor involved, the window. This could be put on either the main screen or subscreen or both, and allow developers to essentially clip out a shape in one of the background layers and apply color maths, either inside it, outside it, or sometimes both. Using HDMA, this window can be modified on the fly, which allowed for some really neat looking effects. You might find some resources that claim the color mass is being done between the different layers. And while yeah, that's not really wrong, technically speaking, the colors are being added, subtracted or averaged between the different screens, which have different layers on them. If you were just drawing all the layers to one screen, and there was no subscreen, it wouldn't be possible to pull off the transparency. It's only made possible because of the unique two-screen setup of the Super Nintendo. If it could be done by just having multiple layers on one screen, then systems like the Mega Drive would be able to do it, as that supported two background layers. But because it only draws to one screen, it can't, and therefore needs to fake transparency using techniques such as dithering. Now keep in mind this is all really high level, as I'm trying to keep this from getting too technical, but if you want more detailed technical information about all of this, I'll leave some links in the description for you to check out. This was the main way transparency was done on the Super Nintendo, and what you'll see in 99% of cases. But there was a second way the SNES could do a transparency effect, but in order to explain this one, I'll now return to that carrot I left dangling earlier when I was overviewing the background modes, and talk about the high resolution modes. Modes 5 and 6 were the true H512 modes. What this means is that the Super Nintendo's horizontal resolution was doubled from 256 pixels to 512 pixels, and the vertical resolution could also be optionally doubled from 224 pixels to 448 pixels by turning on interlacing. Due to the performance hit and limited colors, these modes were mostly only used for menus, with only one known game to actually use it during gameplay, and only mode 5 was ever used. I don't believe any game actually ever used mode 6. So it's a bit of a myth if you see someone say the Super Nintendo's resolution was higher than the competition, because even though it could use these higher res modes, the truth is, most games didn't, and even those that did, used it sparingly. So, modes 5 and 6 were the only modes capable of true H512, but the SNES had a trick up its sleeve that could be used with modes 0 to 4, known as pseudo high res. This was only used in a handful of games, but it allowed a, well, pseudo high resolution. It worked by basically only drawing a pixel at half the size it normally would be on the main screen, then filling up the other half of that normal pixel size space by doing the same thing on the subscreen and shifting the image over by half a pixel. I guess the intention of this was to put the same layers on both screens to effectively double the horizontal resolution, but what developers actually did was put different layers on each screen, which created a 50% transparency effect, as CRT TVs at the time blended the screens together. However, if you look at it on a modern HD TV, you can see exactly what's going on and how it's faking the effect with the alternating half-size pixels. Still, it's a pretty clever use of the console's unique features. It's kind of a pity it wasn't used very much. Here's a few more examples of games that take advantage of this pseudo high-res mode. Thank you. So far, we've only looked at transparency that is being applied to backgrounds, but the Super Nintendo could also do sprite transparency, although this was a bit different. It's still using the color mats algorithms between the main and subscreens that I explained earlier, but unlike backgrounds, where you could apply the color mats to just about any color, with sprites the choices were more limited. Not only was there only one sprite layer, so you couldn't split the sprites between the main and subscreen, but whether sprites could be transparent also depended on what color palette they were using. A bit confused by that? Here's the simplest way I can think to explain it. The Super Nintendo could display a lot of colors, 32,768 to be exact. However, as you might have noticed when I was overviewing the background modes, the amount of colors that could be displayed at any one time was limited, a maximum of 256 in fact. When developers made a game, they needed to choose which colors that they wanted to be able to display at any one time and organize them into palettes, 16 palettes of 16 colors each. Usually with some colors appearing in multiple palettes, unless they were using one of the few modes that could display the full 256. When it comes to sprites, they could use one of the last 8 palettes, labeled 8 to F, but color masks could only be applied to palettes C to F. So, in order to make a sprite transparent, they needed to be using one of these 4 palettes. If they were using the other 4, the effect would not be applied. While this sounds restrictive, it was actually an advantage because developers could choose to make some sprites transparent and some not based on what palette they were using. Keep in mind that regardless of whether sprites are transparent or not, they are still all on the same layer and the same screen, so even though they will be transparent against the background, they can't be transparent against each other. Hopefully, that all makes sense. And don't forget, the SNES had a habit of making backgrounds look like sprites, and sprites look like backgrounds, so sometimes it may not be immediately obvious what transparency method is actually being used. And remember, this could be happening while some other tricks are being pulled off too. So, that's all I wanted to cover in this video, so I'll leave it there. I hope you learned something and have come away with a better understanding of how these effects were achieved on the Super Nintendo, and just what the hardware was capable of. As I said, I'll leave some links in the description if you want more detailed breakdowns of what I've discussed here. It just goes to show you that even though the CPU was clocked at a lower speed than its competition, the graphics hardware was incredibly advanced for the time and allowed it to pull off visuals that the others could only dream of doing. Drop me a comment if you have any questions or remarks, give me a thumbs up if you like this video, it really helps a lot, and don't forget to subscribe to stay up to date with my content. Thanks for watching and see you next time. Drops!